Welcome back to Feels Like Weezer, where we're going over Weezer's catalog, track by track, song by song, from the Blue Album to Van Weezer or OK Human. Not sure which is due out next or last or whatever, or eventual last. Who knows? I am Eric Nash from Almost Famous Minute.
And my name is Martin David Tapia. I'm a private citizen and man about town. And here with us, we've got...
I'm Condra, back again. I'm from the Amateur Nerds.
Yeah, one of our great recurring guests, and coming in here a little bit in the middle-ish of Make-Believe, and it's after our co-host, switching around, Zach having left, but not fully. He thankfully is continuing to edit amazingly, and we appreciate his help that way. But Martin's come in here as of the last episode that our great listeners have probably heard, hopefully have heard, the Christmas celebration episode. We're so glad that Martin's gotten involved, and like I said, Conjure's here too. It's almost like three old pros, except for Martin.
Yeah, it feels like
gone a little while.
Yeah, it feels like Conjure is even more of a pro. Yeah, I mean, you've been on more episodes of this show than I have, right?
I had to look back, and yeah, I've been on three so far. So this will be number four.
Yeah.
Well, and this is number four track of Make Believe, as I was mentioning, is kind of in the middle of it. Hold Me is the song we're doing today.
I am terrified of all things, frightened of the dark. I am. Taller than a mountain, deeper than the sea, you are.
So that was that little snippet there, and I'm going to go straight to our most rookie person for his initial take on the song Hold Me. What Martin, what did you think of this song? What do you think currently?
Holy smokes, what do I think? Hold Me is a beautiful song. Yeah. What a tune. I really like this song. I feel like it's a very simple song, right? Like the lyrics, especially, we're not going to have a lot to talk about perhaps, but I think that the music really sells it. And I think River's voice is really powerful on this one. I think he always kind of has a way of selling emotion or singing and portraying longing, I think, in some way. And I think that works for him very well on this track, and it works for me too.
Longing is I think a great word to describe that. How he sounds. And so Condra, what do you think about Hold Me?
Well, I definitely don't like it as much as Martin does. I think it's a fine song. It's definitely very raw, and this emotional vibe that I don't know if I connect as well. I think also it coming after two songs, which I absolutely love, is a little hard to follow up, for me at least. And also, I don't know if it's just me, but as it begins, it sounds like it should be like the last track of the album, but then it picks up and it's like, oh, are you having an identity crisis? maybe not. I think it's an interest. It's got some interesting dynamics in it, but it's definitely like a very pretty song, and I really appreciate the raw emotion in it, and it definitely feels different. But yeah, it's one of those I will listen to it, but not all the time.
Well, yeah, I can't say maybe I would listen to it all the time. I do like it, I think, that well, but I haven't listened to it all the time except for, you know, in just a little bit of preparing for it. Because, I mean, it's really floated under the radar. It's in the, you know, 20 to 30 listens of Make Believe over the past 15 years for me or whatever, you know, roughly. You know, not one album. It's not one album that I feel like I've said before already in a lead up to this episode, but for this album, that it's not an album that you know, it didn't take me by the head and make me listen, you know, a ton. But it's also this, you know, it's going through the tracks by track for the album and listening to it. To me, it's not something I would go, oh man, that's just a killer, you know, amazing song. But for this purpose, I really do have fallen in love with it, and it's something I think I will try to listen to a lot more here in the coming, you know, days or weeks or what have you, and hopefully longer too. But hopefully it doesn't fade a bit, you know, much, you know, for me. Hopefully I don't forget about it. but yeah, that longing is, I think that's a wonderful word for how Weezer sings it, and it's, you know, it's just such a, like again, like you're also saying, simple. It starts off so soft and clean, but then of course it does punch up a good bit, you know, for the verses or for the choruses, that is. But yeah, so I think we're, it's a generally positive review between the three of us so far, you know.
Yeah.
With your Condra, you're a little bit more on the negative side, but not fully, not real bad, but just
no.
Not
I think
as well, just not as wowed by it.
Yeah, I think it also just surprises me that it's in the first four tracks of the album, like it being in the front half, and it doesn't necessarily sound like a front half track.
Right.
Maybe for modern album standards, but this one always, in looking at like other Weezer albums too, like it doesn't feel like part of the top four, but maybe they were going, like I was reading a bit about the album, and it's like it seems like they're going for a bit of a different vibe, and like that emotion and like vulnerability is more on the forefront, so like to throw this in the top four, like okay, that makes sense if that's the vibe you're going for. I think it's definitely stronger than some of the other raw emotional longing songs on the album, so it's like it definitely like ranked higher than other songs on the album. But yeah,
I have a question about track listings and what you think about which ones should be in the front, Condra. I mean, and by the front I mean the top of the listing, the beginning of the album. Do you think that it should all, if it were up to you, would the best songs always be the first ones on the album? Or would you maybe have like a good one to start? Because I think that's important with an album, right? But then like maybe have some middling ones. Like if you have a really good album, obviously you don't want to have any filler, but sometimes you can't help it, right?
Yeah.
Sometimes every band has to have a little filler. But, like, what if there's, like, a really good track on the end? Like, that's, like, a little treat on, you know, on the bottom of the track list for you to listen to. Do you ever feel that that's a good idea, or do you always want, like, the best tracks to be at the top?
So, I have to balance two thought processes here. One is record and studios and how they organize track listing, which is very much your top hits are definitely in the first five, six songs, and then you have your B-side that's kind of your less boppy kind of songs and your less hits. I notoriously, my favorite song on almost any album is always in the second half. I don't think that's the case for this album in particular, but I'm like thinking Ratitude. My favorite song on that album is Love is the Answer, which is, like, track 8. And, like, I'm trying to think of like Panic at the Disco. I'm a big Panic at the Disco fan. I saw Weezer and Panic. The first time I saw Panic live was at a Weezer concert. So, some of my favorite songs are second half songs. I think it just depends on how well balanced the overall album is and if the tone of the album is complete despite those songs. So, like, if you think Pink Floyd, some of their strongest, like, Dark Side of the Moon, you have Us and Them right towards the end of the album, but that's, like, one of those defining songs for the album. And to have it as one of the last songs and one of my favorite songs off of that album, like, it definitely, as long as it matches the overall tone of the album, but I think it just, you have Beverly Hills, Perfect Situation, This Is Such a Pity, that are such, like, boppy, like much more like their upbeat, more their Buddy Holly style, and then you've got this really raw emotional song, and it's like, okay, big vibe change here, like stop it. It makes you stop and think, like, what are they going for here? But then We Are All on Drugs comes two songs later and is like a bop again, and it's like, okay, what? It feels a little disjointed in that way. But then the rest of the album really slows down, so it's like, okay, is it to warn you that the rest of the album's kind of slower? It's like a hey, heads up, which it could be. I don't know. But for like record studios thinking about how they strategically to have your second single off the album to come six songs in is kind of weird.
Okay, fair enough. I just was curious how you were thinking about that. Yeah. Interesting to me.
Now my thoughts on that are I had already been thinking about from the first two Weezer albums, Blue, of course, and Pinkerton, that, you know, the last song of each, you know, is only mm-hmm. only in Dreams, and then Butterfly, yeah. and you know, kind of I think they both share some similarities to this song a bit. Mm-hmm. But then the very interesting thing is looking at Weezerpedia, and they kind of have a new category, I think, for most of their songs, at least, this band commentary little section of their Weezerpedia, Wikipedia-like pages, what have you. So the very last quote from that is from Brian, and he's saying, for some reason, I liken it to Say It Ain't So. So, and I also can, that, you know, upon reading that, I was like, okay, yeah, you know, a bit, you know, yeah. So, but, you know, Say It Ain't So is like, what, like the seventh or eighth track, I think?
Right? Yeah.
On Blue.
Okay.
So then my only other thought is I love also knowing about when songs are recorded a bit, and I can't actually quite recall for this one how that worked out when they recorded. And I mean, there was definitely the talk of the demo here on the Wikipedia page when that was done in March 6, 2003. And of course the album is, you know, over 2 years later comes out. But my biggest thing I ever think about whenever I'm talking about this kind of thing, recording and where, then also where a song is on in the track listing, is the last song on Revolver by the Beatles. Mm-hmm. my favorite Beatles song, my favorite song essentially ever, Tomorrow Never Knows.
Mm. Okay, yeah.
Yeah. So, and that's for that album at that time in their recording process, that's the first song they recorded, at least most of, you know.
Wow, interesting. Yeah. Hey, and guess what, Eric? Unlike Zach, I'm a big Beatles fan. Beatles good. Person.
So he's gonna hate us now.
I'm old too. Take that, Zach.
I'll talk Beatles. We can go there.
Oh, nice.
Cool.
Revolver's my favorite album.
No, we shouldn't though, because I think that this is a Weezer podcast.
Oh yeah, yeah. This is not alphabetical.
To talk about Weezer.
Fair.
Hey, it's been done. Speaking of Weezer, oh, true. did you guys read about how Rivers was fasting when he wrote this song?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I think that's interesting. I think that's like a weird way to try to write a song, and I think it's a fun tidbit to know.
Well, and then additionally, what he apparently indicated was that, you know, he does not recommend doing it for other people.
Yeah.
And trying to write songs.
Yeah, unfortunately, so, now that I've heard that, I'm going to just keep fasting every time I decide that I want to write a song. And Rivers can do nothing to stop me. He's not my dad.
Rivers is starting a new law enforcement organization of don't fast before you write a song.
He's going to find you.
Go and,
the fast police.
Feed songwriters. Bring food to songwriters.
Yeah.
Fast police.
Yeah, cool. So also, I have like a little theory about these lyrics, because I think that the lyrics are pretty weird. Like, they kind of tend not to mean much. I think on this whole album, like, the lyrics tend to be so broad that they, like, it's kind of hard to relate to them for me. Have you two felt that at all from Make Believe?
Yeah, definitely.
But, like, this song, I decided that it's about, like, a pet, right? Like, a little dog. And, like, that to me, like, once I started thinking of it that way, it really clicked in. And I was like, oh, like, a human being doesn't think about another human being that they are taller than a mountain or deeper than the sea. Except for, like, in a poetic way, I guess. But if you approach it more literally, I don't know. This is how I think of it when I'm listening to this song now. And I only heard this song like 2 weeks ago for the first time. Eric, you said you listened to it like 15 or 20 times in the last like 15 years or whatever. I've listened to it 15 or 20 times in like the last 15 days. So, but I'm really into it. And yeah, once I clicked into my little doggy theory, doggy hold me theory, it's like a dog whose owner doesn't have as much time for them as they used to. It's a very sad song, in fact, I would say.
I would love to see it animated.
Oh my gosh, yeah.
A new music video animated.
Yeah.
With
a dog
like
that can actually hold. Because most dogs can't really hold.
I'm thinking like a little shaking chihuahua or like little white fuzzy dogs. Just one that shakes all the time.
Absolutely. So make it so. Who's in charge of doing that? On the internet. If you're listening, do it.
Well, just within our own network, there is at least one person kind of behind the scenes that could possibly do something like that for us. But
Holy smokes, here on the Pantheon Podcast Network?
Yeah.
All right, very good. Yeah, that's all I have for the lyrics. I just wanted to bring up my little dog theory. And I really like musically I like the bridge, right? Or like the middle eight or whatever you call it. I'm not 100% sure how to talk about the names of parts of songs. But the lyrics to that one are I am cold, hold me. Very simple. But again, like I said in the beginning, I think Rivers like really sells that hard, and I think it's a weird bridge, like it's a weird structure, and like the rhythms of the, like the chords and stuff, like how long each one is held is like kind of bizarre, but I think it, for me at least, it really works. What do you guys think?
Well, is that I am, is that almost a continuation of the completion of the thought? You know, not much a further answer. I don't know of the chorus right before it. You know, take me with you because I'm lonely. I am. You know, he's just saying I am lonely again without saying that word. And it's similar to, you know, I'm right in the very first verse. You know, the second line is frightened of the dark, and he then says I am without anything else after it, and then he goes on to the thought of you are taller than the mountain. So it's I think it's whenever he's saying that I am or I was in the second verse, you know. He's just, it's just a little bit more of hitting the nail on the head, you know, in those cases. Well, I mean, it's, you know, it's the difference between the two, that's for sure, between I am and I was. It's the difference of, you know, currently and in the past, you know, situation, you know, state of being. you know.
Yeah, a perfect situation. That makes complete sense. Also, like, hitting a nail on the head, you should always do that. Don't hit it on the other parts. It doesn't do any good.
Well, every now and then, though, I hit nails on the side, but not strongly.
That's not the rule. Yeah.
To get them to straighten back up.
Almost 100% of the time that you're hitting a nail, hit it on the head.
Right, yeah.
I think it's a good rule of thumb, but don't hit your thumb.
No.
That hurts.
Yes.
I was just taken.
Yes, Condra, go on, sorry.
So I have the liners out from the CD, and the lyrics are just so much shorter than the three previous songs. And it really, like, I looked at it and I was like, wait, is this really how much the lyrics are? Like, how many words are in this song? And then I listened back to it. I was like, oh yeah, it's just a lot of the words are just really held out, and it's more about the music in this song than the words. So the fact that some of the words are very abstract and it doesn't make a lot of sense, it's like, well, that's not the point of this one. It's to show off some emotional music.
Absolutely, I agree, 100%.
And
it's abstract to the point of absurdity, I would say, yeah, for sure.
Yeah, it honestly kind of, like, I would imagine this being, like, a poem more than anything. Like, if I were to see this, like, out of context, not in the liner, but just, like, the lyrics, like, up on a webpage or whatever, I would be like, oh, this is a poem. Just, like, the way it's structured, and even, like, how the liner notes, how they space the lines. So, like, I am cold, it's all on one line, and then hold me's on the next. And it has this very, it structurally looks like a freeform poem.
But
a little bit of literary analysis tossed in there too.
Well, something I often have, that's much more music head on, the music only concerning, is the differences between the right channel, left channel.
Left channel, right channel, left channel, left channel, right channel, left channel, right channel, left channel, right channel.
What is it gonna be?
Derek Nash has some information for ye.
That I noticed that in the verse two itself, I don't think you know, verse one, or is there even a verse three? No, there isn't.
No.
But verse two, there's just the clean guitar that's in the right channel only.
This has been the Left Channel, Right Channel Report
with Derek Nash.
Yeah, right channel only. This is my favorite segment, Eric. I gotta tell you.
Thank you.
I've been listening to the show. I love the right channel, left channel. Maybe I'll write like a little theme song so that we can play it like every time you have something to talk about. But yeah, boy, I am floored, man. I feel like a real Marky Mark here, like a meteoric rise to the top. Feels like Weezer. I'm here. I'm in it. I'm the rock star. Finally, I've made it. Anywho, yeah, has anybody covered this?
And actually real quick first, the other little segment I've been doing lately too, before covers, is actually even the game I play off and on. I've been a little away from it from a little bit recently, but actually as of a couple few months ago, when I actually initially started to do some notes for this song, No Rocksmith is available, at least as of then, for this song. No CDLC, the custom DLC, unfortunately.
Wow, this song is really sad kind of on its own, but that fact makes me even a little more sad.
This one actually would shoot to the top, because I think there was one other song of quite a few months ago now that I thought, man, because there's no CDLC for it, I said, man, if I get the gumption to actually try to create it myself, you know, that's one I would do. I would now, whatever that song was, that is now replaced with this one. This one is the one that takes the cake that I would prefer to do, that's for sure.
Well, the other one, you don't even remember what it is.
Yeah, exactly.
So let's just stick with this
one. I'd have to go through my notes and hope I had it in here, but it's possible I didn't.
I support that. I think that this is like, I'm going to say an underrated song. I have never heard of it until recently, but like, this is the one on the entire album, in fact, that like really grabbed me. And I actually have been enjoying Make Believe in general a lot, so we'll talk about that more in the future.
Yeah.
Anyway, do we want to talk about our ratings?
Well, no. I would say the covers. That.
Yeah.
There is a song, and that's a fact. Now tell me who has covered that. Who has covered that song? Who has covered that song? Let's talk about covers.
For my normal place of looking, no covers, but I did find... three to note. One is very common, and actually I found it pretty good. I did listen to at least a good chunk of it for the Weezer cover project, and that's acoustic, you know, no vocals versions of a ton of Weezer songs. It's a project that whoever it is behind it has done over many years, I believe, even. So that was pretty good.
I'm sorry, and the name of it is the
Weezer cover project.
Oh, okay. Yep.
Yeah. And so there's no indication that they're acoustic and no vocals in that name, but nonetheless it is a project but that's the way they do their covers. But so then the two others to note I thought were just searching it up on YouTube real quick was one called called Jaguar that did a pretty decent cover, I think. I listened to a good chunk of that as well. Nothing too, you know, amazing as far as a different arrangement. It stuck pretty close, but then one that kind of did play a little bit with something a little different was it was three different guys for this one, but it only was the channel was only under one person's name, Matt McLean, and I, you know, so there's one guy, he's a main singer and also playing keys or piano, what have you. There's the other guy that's playing guitar, and a third guy that just came in with some extra backing vocals. So no bass or drums, which kind of makes sense. I mean, it'd be hard to add that, I think, to this song, I think. But the way the guy added some piano parts actually made a lot of sense.
I wonder how many songs actually have keys in them. Like, do you think... Yeah. Sometimes you can shake your keys rhythmically. Maybe there are other ways to... make sounds with keys. Well, anyhow, that's neither here nor there. Go on.
Keys as in keyboard.
Oh. Gotcha.
Yeah. So that's it for covers then, though.
We talked about covers. We talked about covers. We talked about covers.
I would love to ask you about your ratings. Eric.
Me.
Would you mind telling me, how do you rate this song on a scale of 1 to 10? Or wait, do we do 0 to 10? I'm not clear on this.
Yeah, 0 to 10, actually, yeah. Because we
on
are
a scale
allowing,
of zero
because
to
of
10.
The old pitchfork of rating of 0.4.
Aha.
I think that was definitely at least one reason to go sub 1.
Okay, so Eric, on a scale of 0 to 10.
Yeah, definitely won't be the case
0
here.
Being the worst, 10 being the best. What is your rating?
I'm going to have to give this... Yeah,
holy smokes, I'm on the edge of my seat.
A straight 9. Yeah, 9.
Yeah!
Yes.
I love it. What a rating. And now, Chandra, what is your rating on a scale of 0 to 10, 0 being the worst, 10 being the best? How do you rate it? Go.
I'm leaning on like a 6.5.
You know what? Also, I should have asked you first because now I feel like you're rating it higher because Eric rated it so high.
So if I would have done it at a 1 to 5, it was like I wrote down 2.5. So I'm like, I climbed it up
5.
A little.
You should just go with 5.
Well, no, because I think, no, like, after hearing all of your thoughts about it, maybe I'm being a little too hard on it.
Maybe so. I'm not here to change anybody's mind. I'm just here to observe with eyes unclouded by hate. You know what I'm saying?
Indeed.
I'm a real Ashitaka. Yeah. Okay, cool. Now, Martin.
Yeah.
On a scale of 0 to 10, 0 being the worst and 10 being the best, how do you rate this song? Go. I rate it a perfect 10. What an amazing song. I love this song. And you know what? When it comes to songs, it's people work so hard writing them. I don't know if either of you have ever written a song, but it's a lot of work. And to make something come out even halfway decent is so hard. It's too sad for me to rate anything too low. It's just like, you know, even though Rivers is a big rock star dude and like his feelings are not super important to anybody except for people who know him probably. It's, I don't know. It's just, I don't like to criticize too harshly.
I really, sorry to veer off a bit, but...
Please veer.
So, Eric and I have known this song for its entire existence, basically. You have come onto it, you're 15 days in, and it's just really, I'm like having a lot of very, so this was the first album for me, and I didn't say this earlier, which is my fault. This was my first I Know Who Weezer Is album, like, oh, I identify a Weezer song because of Beverly Hills and We Are All on Drugs being on the radio. I was in third grade when this album came out. So this was like my first, like, I can identify Weezer, not just from my parents playing it in the background. And so, like, I wanted to listen to this album and stuff, but I was like, oh, it's not as good and whatever. And it's just, it's really interesting to hear someone who's basically fresh-eyed on it, not jaded about it, like, hasn't had to, like, and thinking to what came after this, like, I just completely shoved this one away when, like, Red Album came out. I was like, no, Red Album is my jam. So it's just...
Well, that's interesting, because I think that people usually, like, the first Weezer album that they hear is, like, a lot of times their favorite. Isn't that the case, I think?
Often, probably.
That's the case for most bands for me.
Well, guess what? I think we got to the bottom of this track, mm-hmm. Hold Me by Weezer from Make Believe.
Yeah, I think so. So, we'll just do some wrapping up now. I guess we should probably just hear from Condra, and then we'll go to our own little plugs. But Condra, what do you have? What would you like to plug today?
Oh, gosh. I'm going to plug my podcast feed. Yeah. You can find it under Amateur Nerds on all the major podcatchers. I'm a Movies by Minute podcaster with my brother. Right now, we are on our season 3, where we are talking about High School Musical 1 minute at a time. I'm also on Twitter at Amateur Nerds.
Yeah, that's great. And hopefully, I think in the green room, we were talking about me hopefully watching Fantastic Mr. Fox soon. So... Then I can listen.
Yeah.
I'd love to listen after watching.
Yeah, you should do it.
Thanks so much, Condra. And so for the show itself.
Thank you for having me back.
Yeah, you're welcome. And so for the show itself, I think we want to talk about, some of the socials. We certainly have our at Feels Like Weezer Twitter feed. Find that. Follow us there. On Facebook, we have our Facebook page at facebook.com/feelslikeweezer is our page. And then the group is the Feels Like Weezer. The group is Feels Like Weezer Listener Society. So you can come and join that. We'll let you in if you're not a bot. And we can talk more about these wonderful songs by the band Weezer, as you know.
Yeah. Check them out.
Yeah,
check it all out.
And as our old co-host would often like to point out, you can certainly email us at feelslikeweezer@gmail.com. And personally, I have just also check out Almost Famous Minute, which that show and this show are both on the Pantheon Podcast Network. That's at pantheonpodcast.com. And I just had my one other Movies by Minute show prior to that was Watchmen Minute, so check those out. And Martin, what do you got?
Yeah, my name is Martin David Tapia. I'm the co-host of the show that you're currently listening to right now. That's Feels Like Weezer, the show where we go song by song, track by track through Weezer's entire discography, from blue to black and beyond. Other than that, I'll see you around. Take it wheezy.
Yeah, this is where we always have our bad endings and can't finish very well.
Oh, I actually have a good ending for this one. I hope you have a fantastic day.
Fantastic.
Yeah. Got it. Nailed it.
Yep, cool.
Sorry, it was complete gut reaction there. I was like, yes.